Harper Audio presents Hostile Takeover, Resisting Centralized Government's Stranglehold on America, by Matt Kibbe. Read by George Newbern.
For Terry, you saw more in me than was readily apparent. You are everything. Their motto is, "Don't tread on me," from Uncle John's Band by Jerry Garcia and Robert Hunter. Prologue, The Hostile Takeover. Imagine a once successful enterprise long ago built on the principles of hard work, growth, and innovation that has grown arrogant, fat, and happy from earlier successes. Achievement, once sought out, strived for, rewarded, is now assumed as given. But there are telltale signs of trouble. Expenditures are skyrocketing even in the face of declining revenues. Debt servicing now dominates the company's balance sheet. Leadership has been replaced with a stultifying bureaucracy, and hard work has given way to cynicism and complacency amongst the rank and file. Customers no longer want what senior management is selling. There was a time when things were good. The customer is always right was the mantra that drove the corporate culture, and the CEO and senior managers vigilantly guarded against unnecessary spending, any hint of waste, or any deviation from the core mission of the enterprise. But now continued success is treated as a birthright, and innovation has been replaced with an aggressive sales pitch for tired ideas and bad products that customers just don't want. It's a story that plays out time and again in the life cycle of a business. Over time, innovators are replaced by bureaucrats, and future managers lose sight of the values and principles that made the venture strong in the first place. As Apple founder Steve Jobs describes it in one of his last interviews, companies often lose their purpose and fail because producers, who had a keen sense for innovation and the drive to constantly create value for customers, are eventually replaced by salesmen simply intent on moving product and collecting new revenue. I have my own theory about why decline happens at companies like IBM or Microsoft, Jobs tells Walter Isaacson. The company does a great job, innovates and becomes a monopoly or close to it in some field, and then the quality of the product becomes less important. The company starts valuing the great salesmen because they're the ones who can move the needle on revenues, not the product engineers and designers. So, says Jobs, the salespeople end up running the company. John Ackers at IBM was a smart, eloquent, fantastic salesperson, but he didn't know anything about product. The same thing happened at Xerox. When the sales guys run the company, the product guys don't matter so much, and a lot of them just turn off. It happened at Apple when John Sculley came in, which was my fault, and it happened when Steve Ballmer took over at Microsoft. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? In America, our political management has failed us, attempting to replace founding principles with a slick sales pitch for tired, bad ideas. The American enterprise grew exceptional based on the bedrock foundations of individual freedom, decentralized knowledge, and accountable, constitutionally limited government. But our leaders in Washington, D.C. have systematically replaced the dispersed genius of America with top-down dictates and expensive schemes designed to expand the power of insiders and protect the privileged positions of politicians and bureaucrats. Senior management has failed us, and it's time to clean house. The American people know that it's time to shake up senior management, and as shareholders, we are acting swiftly to protect our interests and those of our children. But entrenched management, everywhere inside the Beltway, but particularly in the U.S. Senate and the West Wing of the White House, is circling the wagons. They don't want change. Solutions are being ignored and outsiders rebuffed. We know where our problems begin, and they begin in Washington, with a political elite that has neither the will nor the inclination to do what must be done. But we do. And so America needs to take over Washington. Blithely ignoring our entreaties, the powers that be in Washington say, "No thanks, we got this." Our shareholder proposal has been roundly rejected by the CEO and the board of directors. The microphone has been shut off, name placards removed, conference tables broken down, and naysayers herded out the front doors. In effect, America has been thrown out of its own shareholders' meeting. Things are getting, in the parlance of corporate governance, hostile. On August 17, 2010, just a few months before the November 2, 2010 midterm elections, Dick Armey and I called for a hostile takeover of the Republican Party in the Wall Street Journal. The logic was simple. We had to beat the Republicans before we could beat the Democrats. We needed standing within the operations of government, a minority position in the company that would at least allow us entry into the room, a seat at the table. We got more than a few angry calls from the leaders of the grand old party, but we meant it precisely in the exact use of the phrase. Takeovers replace failed business practices and failed managers. Hostile takeovers do the same, but are decidedly unwelcome by the existing management regime. If you think of Congress as America's Board of Directors and the federal budget as the annual operating budget for our country, it is immediately clear that something is fundamentally wrong with our company's management team. In the private sector, showing no cash on hand and an operating debt equal to or exceeding total output, the heads of the entire finance team would roll. Shareholders would act swiftly to protect their interests. When a failing company burdened with entrenched, visionless executives is challenged by insurgent entrepreneurial leadership from outside the corporation, expect those in privileged positions to do whatever it takes to cling to power, regardless of what is best for the company and its customers. Often, CEOs pad their board of directors with friends and other CEOs that manage related firms in a similar fashion. In this case, change is difficult, and any friendly takeover is rebuffed immediately. It's only hostile because the interests in Washington, the political class, the rent seekers, the power hoarders, the government employees for life, the moochers and the looters, like things just the way they are. The mere presence of citizens with better ideas and the will to implement them is viewed as a hostile act. The only way we will ever reduce the debt, balance the budget, and restore constitutionally limited government is if America first beats Washington. In the private sector, a hostile takeover seeks a controlling interest in a publicly traded company against the wishes of current management. When you think about it this way, it seems like a perfect description of what needs to be done to take back control of our government. In our democratic republic, the people need to get involved again. As stakeholders in the American dream, as sons and daughters of liberty inspired by our founding entrepreneurs, we need to take it over. We need to take it back from the Washington establishment and from the crony capitalists that lobby through their men in Washington in lieu of producing better goods and services at lower prices. We need to pry it from the hands of well-heeled progressives that would block the unwashed nouveau from getting rich through higher tax rates and government-imposed barriers to success. From the professional tax consumers, the public employees unions, who feed off the fruits of your hard labor. And from a growing class of well-paid bottom feeders who expect, no, are self-entitled to, a handout, a subsidy, a loan or a payment they did not earn and do not deserve, from each according to his ability, and to each according to the loudest demands. Know that we, the people, will not consent to this fiscal mismanagement by our government leaders. Just like the citizen activists who did not consent to Crown-protected monopoly tea, choosing, instead, to spill it into Boston Harbor. We will not subjugate our voices to the whims of a king, or a czar, or a Senate committee chairman, or even a president. We will not be silenced. The shareholders need to take America back. We need to break up the privileged collusion of Washington insiders and return power from self-appointed experts back to the people. This audiobook tells you how we are going to do it from the bottom up.
Chapter 1. The Central Problem. The chairman tells us this event has to be moved. So decreed the chief clerk of the Senate Rules Committee, Lyndon Armstrong, as he and his colleagues proceeded to expel about 250 citizen activists from the Russell Senate Office Building's Kennedy Caucus Room. It was November 17, 2011, and the room was already packed with regular folks who had traveled from across the country at the invitation of Republican Senator Mike Lee of Utah. Months earlier, Lee had offered to host a meeting of a grassroots group, the Tea Party Debt Commission, in the Russell Building, and had gotten Senate Ethics Committee approval to do so. Together, we wanted to offer a budget-balancing alternative to the Joint Select Committee on Deficit Reduction, a.k.a. the Supercommittee, and provide a hearing where the people would speak and members of Congress could listen. The grandiose, century-old room, officially known as SR-325, with its 35-foot ceilings, was filling not only with senators and congressmen to listen, but also reporters and TV cameras from C-SPAN, Fox News, and other network outlets. The room seemed like an oddly discordant place for we the people to congregate, and a far cry from the street-corner protests Tea Partiers had started organizing in February 2009. As the U.S. Senate website describes it, the interior decoration of the room is classically grand yet refined, much in the tradition of Versailles. 12 Corinthian columns along the longitudinal walls flank 3 French windows and support an architrave and frieze. Above the frieze are classically derived motifs of dentils, eggendart molding, and brackets. A Greek key forms a ribbon at the top of the Corinthian pilasters. A large keystone crowns each window arch, and over the main doorway is a triangular pediment as found in ancient Greek temples. Most who were gathered in the Kennedy caucus room that Thursday in November had made extraordinary sacrifices, traveling many miles away from job commitments and families, to petition their elected representatives with the common-sense proposition that our government cannot keep spending money it does not have. We were not in town to protest. Despite a certain let-them-eat-cake air about the Rules Committee staff, this was no modern-day Women's March on Versailles. We'd come peacefully and respectfully to the seat of federal power to offer budget solutions. The Tea Party Debt Commission, TPDC, plan stood in perfect contrast to the way Washington typically conducts business. The process was completely open and transparent. Everyone was welcome to participate. A series of field hearings across the country asked local residents to take the microphone to offer to the TPDC commissioners, 12 community leaders who volunteered their time to oversee the process, their ideas to balance the budget. The TPDC crowdsourced, i.e. surveyed, 1 million answers to budget priorities online, receiving input from more than 50,000 citizens. This is hardly the way things work in Washington. The very idea of the supercommittee was founded on the proposition that an elite group of insiders knows better than the public what the people want and need. Of course, when you get 12 members of Congress together in one room, each beholden to interests other than the interests of the people, each of the opinion that his or her expertise trumps the will of the people, then you end up with what the country got, nothing. Some would argue this was the goal all along. Contrast the Washington way with the people's way. Our work would quickly balance the budget using the Congressional Budget Office's own scoring. No matter. The chairman tells us this event has to be moved. Our ideas were unwelcome. So were we, apparently. As remarkable as it seemed, we were getting kicked out. Who could possibly be so threatened by a mob of citizens armed with notebooks, spreadsheet printouts, and a budget plan? Who would go to such extraordinary lengths to shut down a conversation, a particularly risky public relations move, given the reporters and cameras, and the way and speed with which information spreads these days? Who told you to do it? Senator Lee asked the chief clerk as Senate staffers collected our name placards and attempted to break down our conference tables. Who was kicking us out of a building financed by our tax dollars? Schumer, the Senate staffer responded condescendingly, referring to his boss, Senator Charles Schumer, the hyperpartisan Democrat from New York and chairman of the Senate Rules Committee. Does the First Amendment have no application here? Asked an incredulous Lee. Simulating a hearing. It is often said that human history is written by the victors. But that was before YouTube. That was before the democratization of information and knowledge online. Julie Borowski, a young economist from FreedomWorks, had the foresight to capture the terse exchange between Senator Lee and the Rules Committee enforcers on her handheld camera just as they were evicting us, and she quickly posted the video on YouTube. This turned out to be the essential record of what actually happened, because as soon as we had left the hearing room, the rules staffers went into full spin mode to cover up what had just gone down.
Sony Bloggy HD Pocket Camcorder with 4 GB memory and 360-degree lens, $79.97. The truth? Priceless. Initially, the Schumer staffers argued that Lee was violating Senate rules by simulating a hearing, despite the fact that senators make a regular practice of holding mock hearings on Senate property. Funny thing is, blogger Michelle Malkin later reported, members of Congress have been able to convene politicized hearings in government buildings for years.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.